to talk about a student project. The very first computational project I ever advised an undergraduate student on was actually just a footnote to something Wojtek had done. See, this is a continual theme here. And in particular, it was a student project that he'd advised, a student project that Pete Skordos had done. Pete was a graduate student who spent a couple of summers at Los Alamos. And it was a numerical simulation of Smoluchowski's trapdoor. Now, you may remember Smoluchowski's trapdoor. It's a spring-loaded door that only opens in one direction. Yeah? Smoluchowski? Instead of a ch? Smoluchowski? Excellent. Okay, Smoluchowski. Is that with a ch? Okay, I said Smoluchowski. Okay, great. All right, Smoluchowski's. Okay, sure, of course, because it would be. All right, so Smoluchowski's trapdoor, and you have molecules on each side, and it's sort of a stupid Maxwell's demon, but it looks like it, at first it might work because molecules coming from one side can push the door open, but molecules coming from the other side would push the door closed. And what Smoluchowski said, I'll get it. Smoluchowski said was that that's not how it works. Of course, what happens is that if there's no dissipation in the door, and you really can't have any dissipation because that's sort of adding a refrigerator, the trapdoor will start bouncing around and it will be completely useless. In fact, it'll be worse than useless. Sometimes it'll knock particles going the other way. And so what Skordos and Zurich did is they modeled this computationally as a 2D gas of hard disks. And they had up to a few hundred gas molecules in the simulation. And because they were hard disks and everything, you could solve for when the next collision took place and figure out algebraically the new velocities of all the particles in the door after each collision. And so you didn't have any numerical integration errors to worry about. And then they saw how it behaved. And they found, unsurprisingly, that it cannot extract useful work from equilibrium situation. It can act as a rectifier for a big difference in pressure. If you have a lot of pressure on one side and not on the other, the trapdoor can act as a rectifier for that. If you add in a term that damps the motion of the trapdoor and sort of allow it to cool, then you can extract work. So that's a very beautiful, very simple computational project that was quite interesting. But what about a real Maxwell's demon, one that actually acquires information and uses it to try to get work out? Well, of course, we all know the story now, but it was pretty cool back in the early 90s. And the key thing is to think about here is the physics of computation. And to think about the fact that the demon, which is an information processing device, has to acquire information and process it and use it. And as Landauer said, the only operations that the demon would perform that would have to be thermodynamically irreversible would be the logically reversible ones. And then Charlie Bennett came along a little bit later, or a while later, and pointed out that you can do everything reversibly except erase information. And Landauer had already reasoned that to erase information had an irreducible thermodynamic cost. The erasure cost in energy was at least kT log 2 per bit in the presence of a reservoir at absolute temperature T. And this connection between the cost of this idea about the erasure cost of information came to be called Landauer's principle. And Landauer's principle is exactly what you need to figure out the story about Maxwell's demon. So here's the Bennett view, the demon operates, acquires a lot of data. If the demon's going to operate in a cycle, it has to erase that data. Erasing the data is going to require it to dissipate some waste heat. And it turns out that it's just enough, that waste heat is just enough to keep the demon from violating the second law. The second law is saved by Landauer's principle. Of course, Wojtek taught us another way of looking at this, said, well, why should the demon erase? What happens before the demon erases? You don't want the second law to sort of be violated for a little bit and then it just it's okay later. And he pointed out that what you really should do is you should have that the physical entropy is our sort of conventional statistical mechanical entropy plus another term, a term which is the Kolmogorov entropy, the algorithmic entropy of the demon's memory. And that the sum of these two is a lot more objective than just the conventional entropy, because the conventional entropy depends on some kind of probability distribution over microstates, and the demon might have a different probability distribution than you have, and so but the sum of these two is a lot more stable. It's a lot more the same depending on who you ask. Okay, but nevertheless, even with this, you still need Landauer's principle to save the second law, because you might erase, and you need to, if you can beat Landauer's principle in the erasure process, then you'll be able to reduce the entropy by reducing this a lot and increasing this only a little bit. So Landauer's principle is the thing that saves the second law. So why is there Landauer's principle? So I want to give a kind of a simple argument for this, which I think has some interesting features. And this is all, I know this is all kindergarten stuff, but that's sometimes useful. So let's talk about a completely classical analysis, though I'll tell you a little bit later how to make it quantum mechanical a little bit. Okay, so let's imagine we have a classical description of a system. We're talking in terms of the microstates of the system. The system microstate is like X. And there's a Hamiltonian evolution. It's important to know there's one Hamiltonian evolution. There is a Hamiltonian evolution. We don't get to change our minds later. It may depend on all kinds of things in the microstate, but there's one Hamiltonian. And it might depend on time. That's OK. And this evolution preserves phase-space volume. And the important point here is that the system that I'm talking about includes all of the apparatus, the control system, any computer memories. It includes everything. If you leave something out of the system, then you might be able to cheat the second law. So we have to include it all in the system. Now, so the system, the microstate, just has some kind of trajectory through phase space. Now, I want to introduce an idea which I want to call an eidostate. What is an eidostate? It's not exactly a macrostate. What an eidostate is, it's something that's denoted by all of the available information about the system at any scale. The eidostate includes anything that you can condition your action on. Okay? And it's not quite the same thing as a macrostate. It's from the Greek word eidos, which means to see or to know. It's the root of a lot of English words. Almost anything ending in oid, actually, turns out to be related to eidos, but that's, I guess we're not a philology conference, we're a physics conference, so off we go. Now, it's not the same thing as a macrostate, though in ordinary thermodynamics, what we usually do is we just forget the distinction. We just think about macrostates and we think that that's all the information we have available to us. But it might not be, as we will see. Now, distinct eidostates are non-overlapping regions in the phase space. They are non-overlapping. They do not have any overlap at all. I'll denote by omega the phase space volume of a particular eidostate. So let's think about this eidostate business. Let's imagine that I have a gas which is confined to one side of a box, and I'm standing next to it, and I know that it's in the left-hand side of the box. That would be an eidostate. Or it might be in the right-hand side of the box. That would be another distinct eidostate. Now suppose we remove the partition and the gas expands. Well, I might remember that it used to be in the left-hand side, although I know that the gas is, it's expanded now. Or I might remember that it used to be in the right-hand side. And the point here is that these things are four distinct eidostates because the degrees of freedom in my memory are included in the system. So these are distinct eidostates. In fact, there's another distinct eidostate, and the one in which I forgot which one it was. That would be a different eidostate. Yeah?
Can I think of eidostate as literally just a subset of the global phase space?
Yes, that's the picture I want to put up. Though maybe...
Any subset in principle.
Can it be a dense sort of reduced density matrix where
I don't need to assume that any subset can be an idiostate. There's one particular collection of idiostates because a set which overlapped this idiostate and that idiostate would not be an idiostate. Yeah, so that it's not necessarily a partition, but it's a bunch of non-overlapping blobs of the phase space. There may be things which are not regular enough to be in an idiostate or something like that. I don't need that. Okay, so for a macro state, we might say that this gas is in the same macro state for all these guys, but these are different idiostates because they're associated with different memory records of me.
You want us to think classically here?
Yeah, I'm just thinking classically.
Okay, so because you don't want us to think quantitatively. I remember this qubit would spin up and then it would spin down and then it would spin up.
No, if I've got a memory record, that's part of the idiostate.
Then there are more orthogonal idiostates than two. So then you don't.
Yes, because the idiostate is not just something about the spin. The idiostate is about the qubit. The idiostate is a property of all the systems involved, including me.
I see.
Okay.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. Yes.
Why is this guy in the middle not just in sort of a mixture of other guys?
Oh well, if I forgot, then. What I'm assuming is that there's a distinct state of your mind for knowing what it was this way, knowing what it was that way, and not knowing. That there's a flag in your mind that says, oh, this memory register in your mind is associated with the previous state of this. The idiostate contains the whole description. Everything you know about what happened, everything that you could use to condition future action is in there. So this is not some kind of mixture of these two. This is a distinct frame of mind.
Ben?
Yeah?
Then, in a more subtle way, those idiostates could all be disjoint because I forget could be disjoint from remembering that it was L and remembering that it was R.
Yes, exactly, exactly. That's got to be a disjoint state because I might take different actions depending on whether I forgot which one it was and if I remember that it was this or remember it was that. I might be able to condition on whether or not I remembered. So, okay. So for each idiostate, we're going to assign a probability distribution over microstates. So each idiostate has a probability distribution. And since the idiostate contains all of the available information, everything we can condition on, there's only one such distribution for each alpha. Yes?
But you insist on putting them on phase space. I mean, somehow, like, it's a little bit more, you would have also to include, another axis to contain the information.
This phase space, there will be, of course, this phase space I've drawn is two-dimensional, but it's going to have enough dimensions to include memory records and all kinds of things. I don't want to. This phase space is not the phase space of some system of interest. It's the phase space of the system of interest together with various apparatus settings and my memory record of experiments that I did and all kinds of stuff. Okay, so it's that all of that information has physical representations, and that physical representation of the information matters. Especially when you talk about things like erasure. Okay? So, the point here is, I don't want to necessarily get in a philosophical debate about what this is, but whenever you do statistical mechanics of any sort, you just have a rule that says, if you've got this idiostate, then you have this distribution over microstates. And I don't really know what that is, but I'm going to require that the support of this distribution is the whole of this blob in phase space because if I only know that I'm in the blob, I really can't exclude any microstate that's in the blob because all I know is that I'm in the blob somewhere. And there's a popular choice just to make the distribution uniform over this at zero outside, but your mileage may vary. I don't really care. There's just one for each idiostate though because the idiostate consists of everything you can condition on. Okay, now, What do I mean when I talk about idostate evolution? Well, idostate alpha goes to idostate beta. That means that every microstate in alpha evolves to a microstate in beta over the given time interval subject to this Hamiltonian evolution. And of course, that's possible only, since volume is preserved by the Hamiltonian evolution, that's possible only if the final idostate is no smaller than the initial one. And if a system's in an idostate, then once it's in that idostate, I have to update the probability distribution because I only have one probability distribution available. This idostate, by the way, contains any memories I might have of what things used to be, remember? Okay? So that's not problematic. And so really, this updating here simply comes to the fact that once I'm in idostate beta, I know everything I know about the, I know everything there is to know. I mean, beta is everything there is to know about the system, everything that I can condition on. And so there is only one distribution that I can assign to it. I don't know what that is. We've adopted some rule. We've agreed on how to do statistical mechanics, but pick one. You can be as Bayesian as you like about this. Okay, so could I have an idostate, alpha go to beta, which goes back to alpha? And the answer is sure, provided they're of equal size. And could I have two different idostates wind up in the same idostate? That is to say, could I have the final idostate not be able to tell which initial idostate it came from? And the answer is sure, but the final one has to be big enough to contain them both, because Hilbert space evolution is volume preserving. And remember, the same evolution does this as does that. Yeah. Correct, unless alpha contains the memory record of being in beta. I mean, if you went back and forth between these a lot, I don't know. You're right. To actually go back to the original one would be something quite striking, and we're gonna be able to do something not quite as striking to make use of this. And so the point is that this can't happen. We can't have alpha and beta both going to mu, and then mu going to one of the initial ones. This is not possible. This is not possible. And that's the fact that I wanted to argue for. So now I want to talk about computational states. So we're going to have a computing machine, which has got a memory register, and there's also some other degrees of freedom around. So C here is the computer state, and S is all the other macroscopic variables, all the other variables I can condition on, you know, the how hot the processor is, and what the battery level is, and so on, how many dents there are in the case, and that sort of thing. And if I have a physical computation, then some computational state goes to another one, and some state of the other parts of the system go to some other state of the other parts of the system, and there's no entanglement or anything because this is a totally classical discussion. And the computation is this: one memory state goes to another one, and the everything else is that happened during the computation is in this evolution, part of the evolution. Okay, now I want to tell you about reversible computation. And if I have a computer that's really, really good, then there are some things that are possible under Hamiltonian evolution. And those things, if you have two computational states, then A and B, then AS can go to BS. This is always a possible evolution. It's not necessarily what the actual evolution of the universe is going to take you to, but it's possible that some Hamiltonian will be able to take you from here to here. And that's reversible because that you could have a remember the Hamiltonian could be time dependent. You could have an evolution that took you from AS to BS and then back to AS. That some Hamiltonian in this interval of time and some other Hamiltonian in this interval of time could do that. And that's why I say it's reversible. So I don't have to actually go. Yeah. So that's what I mean by reversible computation in this. And now I'm ready to talk about information erasure. And this is not quite the way I wanted it to look, but here we go. In an erasure process, we have two distinct computational states, and they merge into one. 0 and 1 both go to 0, let's say. And there's no cheating. It doesn't do any good if we write the information in some other degree of freedom, like a battery level, okay? Because if the computer stores its data, and whether you're at 89% battery or 88% battery, then you could go get that information and get it back after you so-called erased it. So no cheating. That means that the other, not only do the two computational degrees of freedom merge, but the other degrees of freedom also merge. Well, what is this? What is this guy over here? What is S prime? Well, since the reversible by reversible computation, this is possible, and none of these merging and then going back to one of the original states is possible, then it means that S prime can't be the same as SA. And since this is possible by reversible computation, that concludes that S prime can't be SB, and that means that the state of the rest of the computer has to be different from either this state or that state. If we erase data from the computational state, then we have to make a change in some other macroscopic variable of the system. There has to be a change. Okay. And that's really all I want. This is the weak form of Landauer's principle. No process can have as its sole result the erasure of information from my memory register. That's Landauer's principle in its weakest form, and I say that's enough. Okay? I say that's enough. What do I mean by it being enough? Well, let me just first say that you can make an elementary quantum analysis just by replacing phase space with Hilbert space, and your Ido states are subspaces, and the density operators are assigned by some rule, some maybe microcanonical ensemble rule, and so on. But if you do this. And your dynamics is unitary. If you do this, this is still impossible. And the impossibility of this is what you need for Landauer's principle. There's no single time evolution over this region. There's no single time evolution in two stages that would take both alpha and beta to mu and then take mu to alpha. That's still not possible. It's instead of phase space volume that's the problem, it's Hilbert space dimension.
So I missed something at the classical already.
Yeah.
But up here.
Sure.
Why are they orthogonal? I mean, can't I be sure about something?
Can I be sure about something? Why are they orthogonal? Oh, I see. Well, okay. Right. Could you have non-orthogonal Ido states?
Yes. Yeah.
So the motivation of this is that. Is simply that, so Ido states sort of represent classical information. That's the whole thing. That's the whole story. Yeah. Okay. Even in the quantum case.
Yeah.
Okay. So with this notion, with this weak form of Landauer's principle, you can actually do a whole version of thermodynamics that's based on Landauer's principle. And it's built on a reversible Maxwell daemon. This is the kind of thing that Charlie and Wojtek and other people analyzed. It's got a Chouard gas and a reversible computer and a reversible place to store work, and it can be coupled to external systems so that it can do all kinds of things. And without going into too much detail, it can function. You can design such a thing to function reversibly. And it can operate in two different directions. One is it can read information from an external system, read one bit of information and store energy E. It might depend on the external system. And there's also an erase mode where it erases a bit of information and uses energy E, dumps it into the environment. And it can go either way. And the key thing is, since the daemon operates reversibly, what you've got, you're waving the red shirt.
In honor of which, I think you should. Thermodemonics.
That's excellent. Okay, so thermodynamics. All right. So, the point here is that since it's reversible, these energies are the same. And you can, given the weak form of Landauer's principle, you can show that the erasure cost. You can show that the erasure cost is the same for all reversible demons for a given external system. You can show that two external systems in thermal equilibrium have to have the same erasure cost. And in fact, you can just define temperature. You can define temperature by this universal erasure cost for that system. That's the thing's temperature. It's just the erasure cost over K log 2. And the second law, then, in the presence of these reversible demons, the weak form of Landauer's principle is actually equivalent to other forms of the second law that you learned in school. So, for example, here's a picture of a demon that's getting information from this system and energy from this system, and it's erasing it using some sort of process that violates this principle. And once you do that, then this process has extracted heat from this system and turn it into work, and so it violates this principle. And you can show that violating any one of these violates the other two by just looking at reversible demons and reversible heat engines. And so these are actually equivalent statements of the second law. So the weak form of Landauer's principle is the second law. Landauer's principle doesn't just save the second law. Its weakest form is the second law. Okay, but that's kind of fun, but not really interesting. So not that interesting. So everything we've been talking about is sort of conventional equilibrium thermodynamics. What can we say if we go beyond equilibrium? And it turns out that there's some interesting things that you can say. Let me just remind you about work and free energy. Let's suppose you have a system which is initially in an equilibrium state, a canonical distribution, and of energy levels, and you have a Hamiltonian that is time dependent, and it can change fast or it can change slow. I don't care. So if it's changing fast, I might be doing things very far from equilibrium. And let's let W be the work done on the system by the Hamiltonian. And delta F is the change in the free energy. And as you all know, the work done on the system is greater than or equal to the change in the free energy of the system. And equality holds for a quasi-static process that holds close to equilibrium, but the inequality would hold if you went far from equilibrium. Okay? That's all familiar stuff. let's remember that this system might, for example, contain a couple of subsystems. So let's imagine we have a thermal reservoir and another system we'll call B. And the only Hamiltonian that we change is the Hamiltonian of B. The small interaction between these two doesn't change, and the internal Hamiltonian of R doesn't change. And so I only do work on B. B and R might exchange energy. There might be heat transfer between B and R. And so the work that I do on B is the total change in energy of the system, but it's not the change in energy of B. So you can analyze a situation where you have a system that's not isolated by simply embedding it in a bigger system that is, by including the thermal surroundings. The heat bath in it. So this is more general than it looks, because it can include things like that. Okay. Now, some years ago, Chris Jarzynski just had a brilliant idea. And so we do the same thing. We imagine that we have a Hamiltonian that changes according to a fixed schedule. It can go fast, it can go slow, it can be far from equilibrium, it can be quasi-static. And once again, W is the work done on the system, delta F is the change in free energy. And if you average over the initial microstates, Jarzynski showed that this average of the exponential of minus beta times W minus delta F, this average is 1, no matter how you change the Hamiltonian, no matter what this change in Hamiltonian function is, fast or slow, sudden or gradual, it's always 1. This is always 1. Now, that's kind of cool. And it has a lot of, let's derive it really quick. It's actually really easy to derive. But the initial distribution of microstates for the system, A, the initial distribution is a canonical distribution. H sub zero is the Hamiltonian early on. In fact, let's take a look. The Hamiltonian changes from H sub zero to H of tau. The free energy is just related to the partition function. The microstate evolution is some deterministic evolution A to A prime. And the work done is just the difference in the Hamiltonian at the end and the Hamiltonian at the beginning, evaluated at the microstates at the beginning and the end. And so here it is. If I calculate this, let's see. The sum over A is really some integral over phase space. Sum is just as good. I write down what I have. I write down the distribution. I notice that some exponential factors cancel, and I'm left with this, which is a sum over A of this Boltzmann-like looking thing over A prime. But of course, since the evolution is one-to-one, it's a surjective or a bijective map from initial states to final states. The sum over the initial states is the same as the sum over the final states. So I'm summing over the final states of this guy. Now this guy looks like a probability distribution. Is it the final probability distribution? No, you have no reason to say so. But it is a probability distribution. So when you sum over it, you get one. That's all there is to it. Okay. All right, so this is very cool because as a corollary, just by applying Jensen's inequality to this, you get the inequality we had before, but this is much stronger. It tells you about deviations from this behavior. It tells you, can you beat this? Can you change the free energy by doing less work than the change in free energy? Well, if sometimes you have to do more work than the change in the free energy, then it happens that sometimes you have to do less work. This has to average to one, so e to this thing, if that's one, then this thing is sort of like it averages to zero. It's not quite like that. But the point is that work less than delta F is possible, but rare. But it's possible, and I can set limits on how rare it has to be. Okay, so you can find all kinds of great things about not only the average behavior, but fluctuations about the average behavior. Now, just a couple of years ago, Sagawa and Ueda in Japan came up with a version of the Jarzynski equality that applied to systems that gained information. So in there, what they have is they have a system, and there's a control device. They can read some information at one stage in the evolution. They can read some information about the microstate out and use that information to condition the future dynamics of the system. Okay, so they can steer changes according to the information they acquire. And they found that if you just simply add a term about the information that you gather, this is still equal to one. And this averages over all initial microstates and all measurement results, because what you get for this measurement result might not be determined by the microstate. There's no reason to suppose that it is. And the average of I is such that its average is just the information in NATs acquired by the measurement. And as a corollary, the work that you do is at least as big as the free energy minus KT times I, and there's no log 2 because that's in net. Okay, not only did they discover this theoretically, they did a beautiful experiment where they tracked a little microscopic polystyrene sphere, and they moved it around, or they changed the voltages at electrodes, and of course it underwent Brownian motion, and so it went Brownian motion the right way. They used that information to change the electrodes, and they were able to show that if you averaged over a whole bunch of experiments, that this was true. That was pretty cool. Okay, so, but this is not quite Landauer's principle, even though it's close. Because we want to think about operating in a cycle, by the way. It'll make things a little easier. We won't have a free energy term because the change in free energy will be zero. And that would mean that the work done is at least as big as minus KTI Okay, so the average work done by the system, the work done by the system, which is the negative of this, is no greater than kt log 2 times the number of bits acquired. That's pretty good. This is a Maxwell's Demon apparatus that acquires information, but it's not Landauer's principle because everything starts at equilibrium by fiat. The memory and control mechanisms are all external to the system, and there's information is acquired but not erased. So we can do better. We can do something that's more like what we want. So we could be reading or we could be erasing. So I'm going to have, in addition to my thermal system A, I'm going to have a computer memory M. And the microstates of the system will be little M, little A, and the Hamiltonian of the joint system varies according to a fixed schedule. The Hamiltonian initially and the Hamiltonian finally are both the same, and they're both just functions of the A state, because all the computational basis states in here, all the different computational states are degenerate in energy. And the initial distribution, I'm going to assume, is a thermal distribution for the A states and some distribution, and I don't know what it is, for the memory registers. Okay, and so little m is the memory state. Now, the surprisal, this is how Segal and Wada did it, the surprisal is minus the log of the probability of m at any time, whatever that probability distribution is, and the Shannon information is the expectation of that in nats, and an erasure process would have the change in this be negative. Would have the information, would take a memory register that could be a lot of different things and maybe set it all to zero. Okay, so what do I mean by microstate evolution? Well, it's going to be some kind of conditional probability distribution, and I'm just going to assume that conditional distribution is doubly stochastic. Motivation here in a moment. And of course, the first thing being one is no surprise, but doubly stochastic means that if I sum over the conditioned things, it's also one. And special cases of doubly stochastic include a deterministic bijection, just a permutation of the microstates, like we looked at before, but it also includes a situation where you made a measurement of these guys, and you know which one it's in, and then you had unitary transformation, and then at the end you also made another measurement to determine which of these guys it's in. This is doubly stochastic as well. Measurement at the beginning and measurement at the end. Probability is determined by the quantum evolution. And so what we're going to do is we're just going to consider this quantity here. The work is the change in energy of A, and the surprisal is the change in the change in the surprisal is given this way. And sure enough, it works out pretty much the same. You get cancellation as you had before, and then at this next step, you've gotten rid of everything that involves the initial state, and so you can do that sum using the fact that it's doubly stochastic, and this thing is equal to one. Okay, for any doubly stochastic microstate evolution, which includes a couple of important examples. So as a corollary, the work done on the system is at least as big as this, which is minus kt times this, is a corollary from Jensen's inequality. And the negative of delta hm is the number of nats of information that you erased. So this says that on average, at least kt log 2 per bit is required. And so we get Landauer's original principle as a corollary for this. And there's also, we can also set limits on the probability that you would that you could beat Landauer's principle in a particular case. We can set limits on the size of the fluctuations. Okay, so that means I want to talk about a student project. The most recent computer project I did with a student is about a paper by Mandel and Jarzynski that came out last year. They have a device that consists of a wheel, and there's a memory tape and a weight that can go up and down, and a reservoir that's a source of thermal noise. It's not a deterministic model, it's a probabilistic model. And the idea is that the wheel interacts with the weight and the tape and the reservoir, and there's some transition rates that go here. The weight going down or the weight going up happens when you go between A and C, and those things are not equally likely because the reservoir is giving up or taking back some energy. And this model you can analyze very beautifully analytically. You have three parameters: the time you dwell on each tape, and the initial probabilities of zeros and ones on the tape, and the bias parameter, which is related to the temperature. And so I had my student Mark Laris, who just graduated last week. I had him do a big simulation with a 16-bit tape and some parameters. This should say P1, and then we figure out what the final distribution over states is empirically, and we calculate W and delta I for each run, and we ask the question, does this equal to 1? And here's what we get. Okay, so what's going on? Well, this is pretty good. This is pretty close to 1 over here. This is a range of P1 values and epsilon values. It looks pretty awful over here. Most of them are too low, and some of them are really high. But this is like the lottery. If you play the lottery, let's suppose there's a lottery, you had a 1 in a million chance of winning $1 million, but otherwise you get nothing, and everybody played the lottery 10,000 times, most people would say the lottery has an average value of 0. But some people would say, man, the lottery has an average value of $100 because I played it 10,000 times and won $1 million. A few people would say that. And so your data would look like this. There'd be a lot of things underneath the line, but a few things up. And I haven't drawn the highest ones. They're way up. And how do I know that's really what's going on? Well, it's because we tried this. So the average here is dominated by very rare, very large outcomes. This is not a very well-behaved average. How do I know that's what's happening? Well, we tried it. This is where 1,000 runs per point. And it looks like that. And then 250,000 runs per point looks like that. And then 16 million runs per point looks like this. It's amazing what you can do for a few bucks in the Google Cloud, by the way. And so you can see what's happening is the smooth region is getting bigger. Over here, where epsilon's close to 1, that's low temperature. And you almost always erase there. That's low temperature, so it's high beta. And so if you don't erase, that's rare, but because beta appears in the exponent of that exponential, you really win big if you win the lottery here. So that's why this is so noisy. Okay, so let me just add a few remarks. We talked about Landauer's principle. We talked about this Jarzynski-Landauer equality. This is an identity. It implies Landauer's principle as a corollary, and it also tells us a lot about fluctuations. It's not a very easy thing to get at experimentally, but it's not bad. And I want to say a couple things about thermodynamics. In thermodynamics, we're taught that work is a path variable. A path variable. Even in an isolated system like we had, we needed to know the energy at two different times in order to be able to compute the work. So in fact, we could only do that if we had some sort of external record about what had happened to the system. In other words, the work is a function of the eidostate of the system. Not the macro state, but the eidostate of the system. Path variables are eidostate variables. And this even worked out in the quantum mechanics, too, because remember in the quantum problem, we had an initial state that looked like this. We had unitary evolution, and then we had to make a final measurement to decohere the computational basis in the machine and the energy basis in the thermal system so that we would get this doubly stochastic transition matrix. So we need measurement records from at least two different times to calculate things like the work. We need a record of a process. And so it seems to me that thermodynamic path variables, like the work, are going to require us to decohere processes, to have process decoherence. And now that I've said the magic word, I think I will end and wish Wojtek a happy birthday.
Questions? Let's see what Ido states they're in.
Oh yeah. That's the I forgot Ido state.
Curious about your last student project.
Yes.
The numerical simulation.
Yes.
Do you mean that the so-called Jasinski-Landauer relation is violated at that corner?
No.
No.
What I mean is that that even in this diagram, where I sampled 16 million times for each one of these points, I've undersampled.
Okay.
And the statistical average has not converged very well to this theoretical average. Because this theoretical average, this average is a sum of a bunch of terms, and it turns out that one or two or three terms of very small probability but very large value actually determine the value of this sum. And I might miss it a lot of times, or I might get it sort of unusually in an unusually small sample, and so that's why this is noisy.
Okay.
So I'm not saying it's violent. I'm simply saying that it's extremely hard to sample.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
But so an average value like this that has such a large fluctuation doesn't carry much physical meaning.
Well, you know, in itself it doesn't. But on the other hand, if you apply things like Jensen's inequality, you can get something that does have an important physical meaning from it. So I think that there may be some higher order inequalities that you could also get from looking at the exponential.
Well, that was sort of my question. Are the higher ones known? Are there inequalities?
They're not known by me.
Yeah, they're probably not known at all.
Yeah, Charlie.
One of the points you mentioned earlier with the Wojtek work that inspired you, that used both the algorithmic and statistical entropies.
A nice way of thinking about that, maybe a chemist way, is to say that entropy is unusual because it's an extensive variable and it's not the ensemble average of any dynamical variable. But
dynamical variable
whose ensemble average entropy is the algorithmic entropy.
In fact, we've looked at this where we looked at the algorithmic entropy here, and then of course when you have exponentials of the algorithmic entropy, you immediately start talking about the universal distributions.
Yes.
Okay. And you can get some results, but I'm not sure what they mean. Well, you have bounds. What you have is you have bounds. Oh yes, this number. This is between zero and some number, and then, but there's a definite number that it's definitely between. So that's good enough.
I have a second question. So in one of your transparency, you give three statements of the second law of thermodynamics.
Oh right.
Basically, Landau's, Kelvin's, and Clausius.
This is. My antiquarian slide,
Landau's
yeah.
principle, you basically mentioned about the information erasure. And so in my opinion, the Landau's principle is about information.
Yes.
And the other two statements of the second law is basically about a thermodynamic entropy. So here, basically you have Shannon entropy and also thermodynamic entropy. So if you put the three statements of thermodynamics on equivalent footing, so it seems to imply that you are identifying thermodynamic entropy and the information entropy.
Well, what I'm saying is that in the presence of a reversible daemon, which functions in the theory sort of like a reversible heat engine does in the usual axiomatic derivation of the usual development of thermodynamics that you'd see in books, especially older ones, in the presence of a reversible daemon, if you grant the existence of a reversible daemon, then you can show that any violation of one of these things can be turned into a violation of the other. Okay? And so the reversible daemon already makes the connection between the thermodynamic entropy and the information. The connection is in the fact that it can take this and interact with a reversible battery and a reversible computer separately. It can sort of separate out the work and the information. And such a device already makes that connection for you.
So, I mean, at least in such a model, you are saying that we can identify the two kind of entropies, thermodynamic
yes.
and
absolutely. Inclusion. And you can in fact develop all of thermodynamics, ordinary thermodynamics, starting with this as your starting point. And all the things you're familiar with have entropy information interpretations, which is kind of cool, but a different talk.
I mean, for example, in such a model, I agree, but I'm just wondering how general is this kind of relation between the two?
Completely general.
Completely.
So for example, black hole thermodynamics got started because Bekenstein believed this. Okay. Including processes in which you dump information into a black hole. Okay, so this is a very, it says no process, and that's any kind of process. So that's a very general approach. But it's not obvious how it's connected to more familiar approaches. You have to do a lot of work to join them together.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, Charlie.
Well, a fun hobby is to find as many different equivalent ways of stating the second law. And one of the ones that you don't list there is the Kirchhoff principle that you can't mm-hmm. see anything inside a hot furnace by
right.
the light that's on below. But my favorite, which I'm not quite sure is right, is that ice skating is possible because ice floats and it melts upon compression.
Right. I think that we talked about this, and I was convinced of one direction or the other, but I'm not quite sure which one I was convinced about.
Yeah, so please argue that the second law would, yes, we have to solve that.
That's right.